One Niches. That's 2-1 Niches. Another fantastic show for you today. Great guest, joined by Mark Victor on today's show. Mark, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me. It's a real pleasure and an honor to be here.
Absolutely, absolutely. And I'm excited to start the conversation with you because, you know, as I've mentioned on the show before too, we're living during a very interesting time, a lot of change, a lot of chaos, a lot of disruption. And it's also a time where I think, I mean, if you've read history in any way, shape, or form, even poorly, or you haven't even read history and your spidey senses might be kicking up, you might be a little bit concerned about individual sovereignty, freedom, for yourself, your family, and for your community and for society as a whole, regardless of where you are in the world. So I'm really excited to have you on to have this conversation. I feel as business owners and investors, these are the most important conversations we can have right now, because at the end of the day, it doesn't matter how many zeros you have behind your name. If you don't have the freedom to enjoy that, what does it really matter, right?
That's true.
Yeah.
You know, this is a point I see all the time as a criminal defense lawyer. When people come in my office and they're looking at losing their freedom, I can assure you freedom is more important than money. No question about that. Not to denigrate how important money is. Money is important, but it's not the most important thing. Freedom is certainly more important than money.
So for folks that are not familiar with you and what you do, can you please share just a little bit about your background and, with them and what you're currently up to?
Yeah, sure. My name's Mark Victor. I am a criminal defense lawyer. I'm the founder and owner of a law firm that is based out of Arizona and Hawaii. We're called the Attorneys for Freedom. And it is exactly as it sounds. I don't hire anybody as a lawyer to work at this firm unless they are hardcore pro-freedom like I am. And so how do we measure that? Well, we have something we call the Live and Let Live Pledge, which you could find if you go to liveandletlive.org. And so every lawyer at our firm has to sign the Live and Let Live Pledge, which basically says they understand what we refer to as the Live and Let Live principle. Others may refer to it as the non-aggression principle or John Stuart Mill's harm principle, or it goes by lots of different names. And then what we call some aspirational values, which are very important. And if you understand and agree with those, then you are eligible to apply for work at this firm. So we're an activist law firm. We're not shy about that. We do a lot of criminal defense work. We sue the government. We do civil rights cases and civil litigation. We represent people nationally. I'm also a former Marine. You can maybe see from back there on my wall, I got a few things back there. I was honorably discharged, proud to have served in the United States Marine Corps, and shapes a lot of who I am and what I do. And our firm has founded, with the help of lots of our friends around the world, a new global peace movement that we call the Live and Let Live movement. You can find out everything you want to know about that if you just go to liveandletlive.org. Also, information about me and my firm. I like to tell people I'm the easiest lawyer to get a hold of. Just go to attorneysforfreedom.com, or you can email me directly, just Mark, M-A-R-C, at attorneysforfreedom.com.
Fantastic. Yeah. And I mean, that's the core of everything that we do, right? And I did some reflection, even the book that I just finished writing too. What's at the core of all of this is freedom, right? Money is a tool, you know, and it's a tool that can be wielded by someone that knows what to do with it, keep on producing and creating value for society, and therefore it'll result in more capital and deploy it so that it produces more value for society as a whole. And there'll be more capital flung from that. But at the core of all of this, the reason why we're all doing this, the reason why folks listen to this show, is because they want to build their knowledge base of strategy and of tactics to eventually obtain more freedom in their lives, whether it's time, whether it's money, whether it's relationships, whether it's location, or whether it's their purpose, right? So maybe you can speak to that too, and where we are right now in the world, because You were someone that served, that fought for freedom, for everything that this country stands for. And it's seriously something that's very much under attack, whether it's Australia, whether it's South Africa, where I'm originally from, whether it's in Europe, whether it's in Canada. I mean, it's this is a global time where I've never seen anything under attack so much, quite frankly.
Well, look, at our law firm, we are inundated every single day with contacts from people who want to fight mandates of all types, travel restrictions, all these kinds of things going on right now. And we've put some videos out there in terms of how we feel about that and what kinds of cases we take and don't take. But stepping back from all that, look, you got an audience of investors. People know that during times of chaos, even financial chaos, like the Great Depression, there are always opportunities.
Yep.
And so, yeah, freedom is under attack. Freedom, when has there been a time in human history when freedom has not been under attack, right? This is an endless struggle. It's an ongoing thing. But I see huge opportunities here. I'm actually very optimistic and very excited about the time we're in right now because of the prospects for freedom.
Yep.
And so I'm not focusing, and I don't suggest that your people watching this podcast or listening focus on all the crazy stuff going on. This is just a symptom, right? The symptom is of a much bigger problem, which is people don't understand our principle, like what I talked about earlier, the non-aggression principle, what we now call the live and let live principle. We pro-freedom people have done a horrible job. It's our fault. I take full responsibility for this. And we should all do this. We've done a terrible job explaining a very simple, very effective, very obvious idea to our fellow humans, which if we could explain this idea in an effective way so they could understand what the heck we're talking about, I believe most people, and when I say most, I think we'd be north of 90% of the people out there would agree with us. Now, we don't need anything near 90%. If we could get a third of the people on board with what we're talking about, we could make things happen immediately. And I want to emphasize, the world is filled with different projects trying to do different things. There is no project more important than the Live and Let Live global peace movement. It's the most important thing going on in the world. This is not a tongue-in-cheek project. It's not something we're doing for fun. It's something that we, and I say we, because we've got chapters all over the world now. We've got about 10 different countries in Africa, many different countries in Europe and in Australia. We have people. And so all over the place, there are chapters as part of this Live and Let Live movement. And what we're doing differently is we are several things, actually. But one of them is we lead with the principle. We've screwed this up in the freedom crowd. We lead with issues, right? We start with things like, drugs should be legal or taxes or theft. Or screw the government or something like that. Okay, well, these are fun things to say, and I don't back down from any of these positions. But this is not an effective way to communicate our philosophy to other people. They stop listening when we say things like that. Instead, we need to lead with the principle. Before, you will not get me to talk about any issues without first getting an earful about the principle, because that's how I analyze every issue. So we describe the principle now as the live and let live principle. It's a phrase that almost everybody agrees with when they hear it. They don't say, what the heck does non-aggression principle mean? You were pacifist. We don't have any of that. We get basically, yes, I love live and let live. And so we're pushing this from the principle first. And what we're saying is all laws everywhere should be calibrated around this principle. And for your listeners who don't know what I'm talking about, let me just break it down very quickly. The principle basically stated simply is don't be an aggressor. Okay, what's an aggressor? Somebody who initiates force or fraud or coercion against another person, or somebody who does something that creates a grave risk of harm to another person or their property. Put someone else in harm's way, in other words. Don't do that. If you do any of those things, you're violating the principle and you are acting, in our opinion, illegally, and we should do everything we can do to stop you. But if you're not violating that principle, very, very important, you should be left alone. Even if we decide what you're doing is not smart or immoral or unwarranted or unhealthy or something, or a bad investment or something. You have every right as a free person to engage in acts with your property, which is your body, your property, your money, your time, any way you want, so long as you don't violate that rule. Very importantly, we take the position that this rule applies to everybody. Our movement is, we like to say, post-racial. We don't care about the color of your skin or where you were born or what foods you eat or language you speak or what any of that stuff. We don't care. We agree with Martin Luther King. The content of one's character is more important than things we don't care about, like the color of their skin. Our tribe are the people of the world who agree with this principle, this live and let live principle. So it applies to every person, even if people form groups, right? If we get together and form a group, we don't get to violate the principle. Even if it's a big group, even if it's a corporation, or even if it's a government, no person, no group, no corporation, and no government should ever be allowed to violate that principle. Now, that's generally where the freedom crowd stops. And they go then from there and talk about issues. But we're a peace movement. And as a peace movement, we have some additional things to say, because freedom, while a necessary prerequisite for peace, isn't sufficient. We need something else to get to peace. This is where we talk about the aspirational values, things like open-mindedness and tolerance and voluntary kindness and civility and a commitment to truth and facts and reason. We care about this stuff because our goals in this space are to maximize human happiness and minimize human suffering. We don't want to change the law to force anybody to be open-minded or civilized. You have every right to be closed-minded, intolerant, uncivilized, and unkind, so long as you don't violate that rule. You're not part of our movement, because our movement is seeking people who are promoting these values, because we're a peace movement, but you should still be left alone. And we take the position, even if you're a jerk, as long as you're a peaceful jerk, you should be left alone. So we're unveiling this movement. We haven't kicked it off yet. Your listeners are hearing about this pre-launch. We don't launch until March of 23. And the reason we're doing that is we want it to be a world-class movement. What's up and running, that's got momentum. And this has already exceeded our growth projections, where we actually had to pull back a little bit to deal with infrastructure and things like that, and to deal with the chapters. And everybody's clamoring for more information and events and things like that. And so the excitement is tremendous. This is why I'm saying this is a wonderful time. I mean, if you were, I'm going to unveil a global peace movement, you would want a time where the entire world just went through or is going through a single event like we are now. Yep. You would want a time when virtually everybody's upset with the status quo. Whether you're an R or you're a D, you're probably pretty upset with how things are going. And the clamor for change is very high. And so our community now is a global community. Whether we like it or not, we're not going back to little local I mean, look, local communities are important, but to ignore the fact that we trade globally, we travel globally, corporations are global, we can invest globally. We're a global community. There are threats globally. Look at what we just went through. Somebody did something in China. I don't know whether it was a wet market or an experiment gone bad, but somebody did something in China that created substantial risks that actually materialized into real harm all over the world. And now we're dealing with all kinds of regulations and problems as a result of what somebody in China did. So we can't bury our heads in the sand any longer. We need to unite. We need to get the reasonable people of the world to unite around an important principle and to say, look, ethics are important, but we don't put them in the law. We are clear about the difference between a legal rule and a moral rule, right? It's possible to say consistently, maybe I think prostitution is immoral, but I think it should be legal, not illegal. The same can be said for drug use. The same can be said for many different things. Like, we have to get here. And frankly, I say this with the intended force. If we're going to survive as a species, We need to get our heads around a principle that's going to ferment peace and freedom, because it's, as you know, it's easier and easier for smaller numbers of people to do larger amounts of harm. We have all kinds of threats coming that we got to grapple with. We're not even talking about these things coming up, and we need to be. I mean, this pandemic was a warm-up. There's synthetic biology now where bad guys and gals in the world are working on deadly viruses to intentionally distribute through the world. We got to get our heads around a principle that we can contour the law around so we can deal with these threats around the world. So anyways, I'm writing a book about this. If people want to get some information, they should go to liveandletlive.org. You'll see a series of videos there. There's some FAQs. You can pre-order my book. My book is a deeper dive that will go through this principle and these values, and then a parade of issues. How does it apply to the gun issue, the abortion issue, animal rights, the drug war, euthanasia, taxes, racism? And I just apply that principle, which is a very simple principle. Once you get your brain around the principle, you'll find all these issues are pretty easy to resolve, right? Who's the owner of this property we're talking about? Maybe that person should make a decision about what happens to it instead of somebody else. And so property rights, of course, are important. We know we can't get anywhere in a civilized society without a commitment to property rights. And then we have to deal with how we interact with each other. And that's this principle, right? You don't get to impose your will on another person. We're all equals. We all have a right to both define and pursue our own happiness. I don't get to tell you what makes you happy. I don't get to tell you how to live your life. We can cooperate and voluntarily get together and do whatever the heck we want to do as competent adults, but we don't get to impose on each other against each other's will. Another way of saying this is voluntary interactions should be legal and involuntary interactions should be illegal. It's really not that confusing. We got to do a better job getting our message out there. For people listening to this, start a chapter, donate some money, get involved. You damn sure should blast it out on your social media. We need to get the world moving in the right direction, and you need to help. If you care about what's going on with the planet, the least you could do is blast around the website and encourage people to take a look.
I love that you're leading with principle and not the issues too, because it's the same thing with business and investing, where the focus should be on strategy. The tactics flow out of that. You know, if you're only focusing on the tactics, then, you know, without any strategy, well, tactics change and very, very quickly, especially during the time that we're living in, where there's incredible things happening, a lot of disruption, a lot of change, a lot of chaos. It's the fourth industrial revolution, right? So from a business and an investing perspective, we lead with strategy and we then utilize some tactics, but it's all done strategically. From a standpoint right now of creating change. I mean, I couldn't think of a better way to do it than leading with principle. It's refreshing to listen to. And I think that's why there is, I mean, we talk about the Great Reset in many different areas. I think there's a political reset too, where folks are sick and tired on both sides, left, right, wherever you want to put yourself on the spectrum. I think they're all sick and tired of issues, and they've realized that everybody's been played against one another. But if you bring in principles like you just mentioned, well, now it's something that everyone can agree on. We don't have to agree on all the issues at all. No one's ever going to do that, ever.
Right. We should acknowledge this.
You're spinning your wheels. Yeah.
Right. Philosophers have been arguing about morality since we've been able to argue, and they haven't yet agreed. And it's not critical that they agree. What's critical is that we agree on some basic things, what we might call the least common denominator of morality, right? Show me a successful moral code that doesn't outlaw initiating force against another person or aggression or fraud in some way. So this is what we should agree on and make into the law. Even if you don't agree, too bad. You don't have a right to be an aggressor. But this focus on principle is absolutely critical. Shame on us that we don't educate our kids better in this area. And this is, of course, because we have allowed a one-size-fits-all government school system that decides in Washington what people should be taught. We need to change this as well. We need to educate our kids in terms of things that are important, starting from principle. Everything has to start from principle. That's the foundation of what you can't even have a strategy until you know what your goals are. You got to begin with the end in mind and think about this carefully and then proceed based on important bedrock principles in your life. That's what our movement strives for. In fact, this is what's made me a successful owner of a law firm. I run my business on certain principles. I don't do a deal with anybody at any time, whether it's personal, business, or otherwise, unless it's win-win. If it has to be more than just in my interest, it has to be a win for the other person, because a win for me and a loss for someone else is ultimately going to turn into a lose-lose for both of us. So I try to focus only on win-win deals, whether they're personal or whether they're business. I don't do anything unless it's a win for me and a win for the other person, which means I got to understand what a win is for the other person. I can't guess about what a win is for you. So I got to seek first to understand and then to be understood. So I listen and I try to understand another person and get what it is they're coming, where they're coming from, what's important to them. And then I craft an out-of-the-box solution and try to find a win for them. That's also a win for me. We should proceed this way with all of our business relationships and all of our personal relationships. In fact, building high levels of trust is so important. That's why we put it as an aspirational value, because we just met. But one thing I know about you already and all of your listeners is that if I said, look, identify the good relationships in your life, you would give me the ones where you have high levels of trust. And if I said, identify the bad relationships, those are the ones with low levels of trust. So with this information, we know building high levels of trust, the importance of keeping your word and being where you say you're going to be and doing what you say you're going to do. This isn't just, as we said in the Marine Corps, happy horse shit. This is really important, valuable stuff that works. There's a reason why what you might call the old school values are old school. They're old school because those are the ones that work.
Right. And they've been passed down from generations to generations in some way, shape, or form, maybe communicate a little bit differently. But some of these, the non-aggression principle, right? And using force or aggression against anyone else in the end or their property. We've pretty widely accepted that this is kind of the standard for living on this planet for a while until our groups became so big and became governments, right?
Yeah, somehow we forget. It's easy to explain to another individual that they shouldn't be an aggressor, right? Almost everybody agrees on that. But then it starts getting confusing. We start forming groups. Can the group aggress? And so when I explain this to people, I like to start with a small group. What if me and you and another guy, the three of us get together, do we get to violate the rule? And everybody will say, why would you get to violate the rule just because you formed a group, right? Yeah. Well, what if we formed a bigger group? What if we had hundreds or thousands or hundreds of thousands of people? Could we then violate the rule? And they look at me like, why would the size of the group make a difference? And so, of course, we apply this to corporations. Look, I'm a capitalist, but I don't want to give corporations a break here. Corporations don't get to violate the rule any more than anybody else does. So we don't argue about capitalism or socialism. This is very different in our movement. I don't make the case that socialism is bad or capitalism is good. I say, do whatever you want to do, just don't violate the rules. So free market capitalism, nobody's violating the rules, so that's perfectly fine. Crony capitalism, where maybe people give money to politicians to pass laws to advantage or disadvantage other groups. Okay, this is using coercion. This is, for that reason, outlawed, should be outlawed. Same with socialism. If people want to get together and pool their resources and spend them on any common things they choose to spend them on, who am I to tell them how they should run their lives? So socialism, voluntary socialism, is perfectly fine because it doesn't violate the rule. But involuntary socialism, where people do exactly that and then drag other people into it who don't want to be into it, we don't have to get into an economic discussion about curves and things like this. All we got to say is, look, we're committed to this rule. And when you drag somebody into your financial arrangement, you are violating that rule. And for that reason alone, we don't need to get any further down the road about what raises standards of living or anything like that, even though we know the answer to this, right? It doesn't. Right. You can simply look around the world and see that free market capitalism raises standards of living, but maybe people are committed to other values and things, and who am I to tell them what to do? This is an easy way to explain really how we can get to peace and freedom. And, you know, when you say people are upset and everyone's mad in the Republic, this is music to my ears if we're trying to unveil something new. We want to say, look, sort of something new, right? I mean, live and let live, that phrase has been around a long time. The principle's been around a long time. But the way we're packaging things and presenting things in our edition of the aspirational values, which are critically important. Remember, this is in an ethics realm. No, we're not trying to change the law to force people to act ethically or anything like that. So as you can see, this also provides a very good vehicle to explain the difference between an ethics rule and a legal rule. And we have to get this through our heads if we're ever going to get to a free society, because people confuse these things. They say, look, I think prostitution is immoral, therefore it should be illegal. That's what we got to combat. We got to get them to understand the difference between these two radically different realms. And they're critically important, right? Because if you violate a rule in the legal realm, there's going to be consequences. There'll be formal, societally imposed consequences. If you violate an ethics rule, we don't have those types of consequences. People might not like you or something, and they may choose to not to do business with you, but nobody's going to put you in jail because you violated an ethics rule. And so we need to be clear about this very important difference between these two types of rules. And so that's what we're pushing very, very clearly with Live and Let Live, and we're doing it in a very inclusive kind of way. Our approach here is we're all brothers and sisters. We're so fortunate to be alive at all, and that we're alive at the same time and crossing paths, that we get to talk to each other here is just this is almost an astronomical kind of possibility here, that we would both be alive, that we'd both be alive at the same time, that we'd both cross paths and have a conversation. I'm going to be upset with you because the color of your skin is different than mine, or you eat something different, or you were born, you have a different accent in your voice. What, this ridiculousness has to end. It's 2021, and the reasonable people of the world need to stand up and say, enough of this crazy divisive stuff. We're brothers and sisters. Let's unite, get together. Let's insist upon peace and freedom and make it happen, period. We got to get it done.
Yeah, absolutely. And to your point, we've talked on the show about there are a ton of issues, you know, in the economy, markets. I mean, we could talk about that for hours. But from a business and investing standpoint, when you do your threat assessment of what's going on, the threat yourself, your family, your business, your investments on a daily basis, there's a ton of pain points, a ton of problems, a ton of challenges, which leads to an enormous amount of opportunities, a plethora of opportunities for entrepreneurs and for investors, because people are looking to solve all of this. They're looking to solve pain points and problems and challenges. The same can be said from a societal standpoint, where we're so polarized, it's so divisive, there's so much chaos. So something like this is a breath of fresh air, where you're like, all right, let's start to be reasonable here. Here's a practical solution where we're leading with principles, not issues. Because currently, I mean, if we're looking at the world, this is what it comes to when we're just discussing issues. But if there's certain principles that are we hold to the gold standard, which, as we've discussed, we could pretty much all agree not aggressing against other people and their property is it's a pretty good principle through our time. You do that, and all of a sudden, you know what we need to do wherever you live or in the town and your family and so forth, because all of a sudden there's something that we can all agree upon. So we could all lead to try and create that world that we live in based on this certain thing. I mean, all of a sudden everything falls to the wayside, right? This new form of segregation and the mandates and all that stuff is out the window if you have principles.
Yeah. And I think it's important too, because I see, you know, it's easy to say, hey, I'm a freedom person, right? If you get in any crowd and say, raise your hand if you're for freedom, everybody will raise their hand, right? I mean, Saddam Hussein said he was for freedom. All of the horrible dictators of the world, they're all for freedom. And so we got to put a little bit more of a point on this. And people who say they're for freedom sometimes mean what they are in favor of is that the world ought to be ordered in the way they want the world to be ordered. And so we get a lot of people, and again, we're the attorneys for freedom. So you can imagine we get a lot of inquiries for people who are upset about mask mandates and things like that. But, you know, just like with the gun issue, I speak to the gun community. I'm in a very pro-gun state here, and there is no more high-profile pro-gun attorney in the state of Arizona than me. I've been speaking at the Crossroads of the West gun show for 20 years now. I'm the only lawyer who gets to speak there, and that's just the tip of the iceberg. But what I tell the gun guys is they get upset sometimes when they see a store or a restaurant or some private business that says, no guns allowed. And they call me and say, Mark, we got to change this. I got a Second Amendment right to this and that. And I have to explain to them, the Second Amendment has nothing to do with this situation. This is a private business making a private rule that you don't like. And you have no right to tell that private business owner what rule they can have. Your rights are to not go there, to protest, to be upset. You can do all of that, but you don't get to impose your rules on that private business owner. Well, the same can be said about masks and vaccinations, right? So long as we're dealing with an actual private company and they're not being forced by the government or somebody else to make a rule, if it's a voluntary choice, and a lot of employers are in this box, it's not a choice that I've made for my firm. We have never had a mask mandate at my firm throughout the entire pandemic. We stayed open. We didn't, I mean, it was everybody's choice to wear a mask or not. Nobody at my firm wore a mask. We met with people. We had no problems. Maybe we were very lucky, but that was my choice. I could have said, look, you have to wear a mask. I could have said, you have to be vaccinated if you want to work here. I didn't say any of that either. But we need to be clear about the fact that just because a business or another person makes a rule that we don't like doesn't mean it's an anti-freedom thing, right? Freedom is the right to control your property, not somebody else's property. So it's been a little disappointing to me about how many people have come to my firm and said, you guys are the attorneys for freedom, and I'm a big pro-freedom activist, and I don't like the rule that, you know, Walmart has said you can't come in without a mask, and I'm coming in without a mask. And I try to explain to them, you're in the wrong here. You're trespassing. So now this is not the case for government mandates. That's a different story. If the government is telling a business you have to do this or that, well, we're always against that. I don't even reach the question of what it is they're telling the business. The business gets to decide under what circumstances somebody can enter, and it should be to work there or shop there or whatever. That's what freedom requires, right?
Yep.
And so peeling this apart in a way that makes sense for people to understand it. They don't see the world and now this jumble of unrelated issues that are all little separate questions, but instead see a unified vision of how all of these issues can be analyzed with the same exact reference to the underlying principle.
Yeah. You make the best decision for yourself, your family, your business, and your investments, and you allow other people to make the best decisions for themselves, their families, their businesses and their investments. And that's how, you know, a free society kind of operates.
And feel free to try to persuade. Say, that's a terrible investment. Don't do that. I wouldn't do it. You're a fool if you do. You can do all of that. That's fine. I prefer more civilized discussion. But look, you have every right to try to be persuasive. You just don't get to be coercive. That's all. It's a simple rule. It makes a lot of sense. I think it works out. Look, it works fine for everybody except the thugs. Right. If you're somebody who enjoys initiating force, you're a thief, you're somebody who commits assaults or burglaries or things, then you won't like my rule. And that's OK. I don't mind disappointing these people. We get to say to them, sorry, you don't get to do these things. And if you do, we're going to put you in jail. I think that's perfectly fine. But for everybody else, be in charge of your own property. You know, I refer to this in my book as the kindergarten rules. Remember when you went to kindergarten and the teacher and probably your parents said, look, here are the rules. Keep your hands to yourself and don't take the other kids' toys without their permission. I found those very good rules in kindergarten. I noticed when I went to elementary school, they were still good rules. Nobody said, Mark, we're stopping with these rules. And all the way through law school, I found that these are still good rules. I still don't find any reason to depart from these rules. I try to follow them. It's how I raised my kids. I think they're excellent rules. I think we should really adhere to them.
Absolutely. One of the things that you mentioned too is the persuading and ideas, right? I think also the way that you're going about this with principle, it opens up a civilized conversation, which this is, it used to be a national pastime, I guess, but it's long gone. But the conversations are gone and the persuasion, but it'll bring people back to the table and saying, listen, we're not going to argue about again, issues. We're going to talk about principles. Here's something we can all agree on. You know, we're all reasonable people. Back to your point of keep your hands to yourself and don't steal other people's toys. Pretty good starting point.
If we don't have agreement on that principle, why would we even talk about issues? We're talking past each other because I'm always trying to apply the principle. If you don't agree with the principle, then let's talk about that. We shouldn't be talking about issues yet. If you agree with the principle, okay, great. Now let's have a conversation on how we stay true and faithful to that principle.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. It's definitely going to open up a lot of different avenues to explore. And, you know, what's so interesting is I talk about principles and values in the show, and we've been doing this show for 6 years because of exactly that. It's something that you can pass down that's timeless, that if you keep it pretty structured and simple, it's something that could be kept for generations within your family, especially if you're trying to create a legacy, which a lot of our audience is. So a core message in our show is to leave our families and communities and the world better than we found it by passing down a mindset, principles, and then values to generations, not just money. Because we could talk about strategy and tactics and business and investments and so forth, but it's that intellectual capital being transferred to the next generation, which is so important. So I know that this question will align with you, but if you cannot pass on any money to future generations and we're only allowed to pass on three principles to them to build wealth and achieve happiness and success, what would they be?
Well, excellent question. I wish we could do a whole show on just principles. And let me just put a plug in here for my very favorite book ever written, which is The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Stephen Covey. I feel so strongly about this book that I shut my law firm down at least once or twice a year, take everyone in my employ to an offsite location, and we talk about that book all day long. And I never get tired of it because these are timeless principles. But let me tell you where I start. I think the most important concept to get your brain around is this notion of perspective, because I don't care what circumstances you're in. If you get the right perspective, you'll be happy. For example, I'll give you a great example that I borrow from my wife, who was born in Burma, otherwise known as Myanmar. She's from a third world country, and she's climbed the ladder all the way up from being born in a third world country to one of the most highly respected cardiologists in the entire Southwest here. And one thing she says to me all the time is when I'm crowing about some problem in my life, she says, you know, Mark, first world problems. And I've added to this, and I now say, you know what? And we are so privileged to have first world problems, right? Something happened to my Mercedes and I'm so upset, right? This is a first world problem, right? You're lucky enough to have a car, let alone a Mercedes. And so if you keep the right perspective on virtually any situation, right? I mean, think about how lucky we are to even be alive at all. As long as you're alive, there's still more hope for happiness and good things to happen. So I would say perspective, number one, the most important concept to get your head around for your overall happiness. A second, I'm fascinated by the concept of balance. I think balance is absolutely critical. Again, my wife has been influential on me here. She's Buddhist, and coming from the Eastern tradition, balance is a very, very important. Look, the live and let live movement is a great example. I am not dedicating every minute of my life to improve the world by pushing the live and let live movement. I don't think you should do that either. There's a section of my time that I commit to improving the world, and I want to be as effective and efficient as I can be in that space. It's probably a bigger slice than it maybe should be, because I'm a big believer in this, but it's not everything, right? I'm a dad. I spend time tonight. I have time set aside to have dinner with one of my kids, which I do on a regular basis. I'm a husband. I'm a son. I'm a neighbor. I have other things that I do in my life. There's things I do for self-improvement. I have my own mission statement that I read once a week and improve on. So balance in all things, right? I don't think I'm kind of a healthy guy, but I'll peel off a piece of chocolate cake every once in a while and eat way too much of it. But I go to the gym 6 days a week. And so you need to balance saving and spending, right? Because I've seen errors on both sides of the equation here. People who spend everything to get and save nothing, and people who save everything and die rich and didn't enjoy a penny of their money. So I think balance is an absolutely critically important. You know, if you only give me three, it makes it really hard. but I'm probably going to say this notion of building high levels of trust with other human beings. You just can't, you can't overstate how important the value of trust is, right? Because it's so easy to blow. It's so easy to screw up. I think we underestimate how even a small violation of trust can really ruin a relationship, any relationship. So I would just implore people, as I do often, to be very, very careful. I tell my kids, you don't have to promise to do anything at all. You can say, look, I'm not making that agreement. But if you make an agreement, whatever agreement you make, you damn sure you follow through, you deliver more than you promised, because of the value of that trust is so important. If you, you know, and trust, you can get things done much more quickly. As I've noticed, trust is we're a zero tolerance at our firm for trust problems. I don't want to have to spend extra time reviewing this and reviewing that. And I do handshake deals with people all the time, no problem. Because we have that high level of trust, we don't need to write it all down. So trust really increases the speed of getting things done and lowers the cost of getting things done. We don't have to buy, maybe you don't have to hire lawyers to do certain things, and the transaction cost of getting things done can be so much better. And so if I had to smuggle a fourth in, I would say this idea of win-win, because don't, if it's not in the interest of the other person, don't do it. Don't do it just if it's in your interest. So if you follow these principles, you're going to dramatically improve your life. There's just no way you're not. I'm a living proof of this. The better I got and the better I get at adhering to these principles, the better every aspect of my life gets. So yeah, principle is really, really important. And thanks so much for pushing it on your show, because we really need to get back to the concept of important, fundamental, basic principles. You know, this notion that nothing is important and that we can do anything we want with no restrictions, this doesn't get you very far in life. And it doesn't lead to a very happy life, in my opinion.
Absolutely. This has been an absolute blast. Mark, where can folks learn more about you? Where can they follow you? Where can they stay in touch of all these different projects that you're involved in, and reach out to you folks if they need any of your legal services?
Well, what I really love people to do is be inspired to help in some way. Whatever you're doing right now to improve the world, I would say stop doing that and help out with the Live and Let Live project. Not because what you're doing is not important, but there's nothing more important than getting to world peace, right? We got nukes all over the planet. We got AI coming. We got all kinds of other problems. Like, we got to get a hold around the world on this principle, this Live and Let Live principle. So go to liveandletlive.org. I don't expect people to spend their entire lives, but if people are in a position to donate some money, we're a 501c3, get your tax deduction, donate money so we can get the word out. If you want to start a chapter, again, we're pre-launch right now. Make it your movement. Be the founding person in your area for the Live and Let Live global peace movement. I promise you, if you come and join our meetings, our monthly meetings that we have for chapter leaders, you're going to leave inspired. When you see people all over the world blasting the shaka, which is the symbol that we use, the Hawaiian shaka, and saying peace and freedom, and we're all united around this, and people with different accents and different color skin, and we eat different foods and this and that, we're all united around this principle. Get involved and help with Live and Let Live. If you're interested in our law firm, or you got a case that's an activist case, we love bringing freedom type cases. That's what we do. Go to attorneysforfreedom.com. And look, even if you disagree with anything I said, I'd love to hear from you. I always improve my presentations or what I'm saying by incorporating critiques of other people. So I'm happy to hear from people, whether they agree or disagree. There's also a podcast that we're doing. It's at Live and Let Live. It's called The Peace Radicals. And we had last night on our show a very religious Muslim who's also a doctor, who's for Live and Let Live, and made the case that if you're a Muslim, like over a billion and I think a quarter of people in this world are, you should be for Live and Let Live because you're a Muslim. So what an interesting pitch that is, and that will be coming out soon. So check out Peace Radicals and blast it around. Look, minimally, do what you can to get some attention on the Live and Let Live. Go to the website, join the movement. All I need from you is your name and your email address, and now you're part of the movement. We want to say we got 10 million people behind us, and we demand action. Maybe we'll do marches. Maybe we'll have people run for different offices around the world, all as a Live and Let Live whatever. Wouldn't it be wonderful to have sort of an informal global political party called the Live and Let Live Party that runs candidates who are all pushing the same thing, whether regardless of whether you're a Republican or a Democrat or a Libertarian or something else in some faraway place, be a Live and Let Live whatever. So there are countless things that people can do to help out with this, but don't do nothing. You're on the planet. Undertake some effort to leave the place better than you found it, right? We all benefited from the work that was done before we showed up, right? We got nice roads, there are reasonable laws and things like that. Not perfect. We're still, you know, part barbarian and part civilized, but this is a long intergenerational project to try to improve life on Earth. Do what you can to help out. And basically, that's my pitch. Hopefully, I inspired some people to get involved and help out. And certainly contact me directly if you want to do a chapter. I'd love to work with you. We'll come. There's not a huge commitment here. Run a meeting once a month and show up at our monthly chapter leaders meeting. And then when some hotshot gets in your group, you can turn it over to the hotshot. But let's get the ball rolling. So when we launch in 2023, we got good momentum.
Absolutely. Well, this has been a blast. Thank you so much for coming on and sharing all of your knowledge and this incredible energy and great principles with my audience. It's been a lot of fun connecting and having you on.
Yeah, and thanks for having me. It's been a real pleasure. And thanks for everything you do. I love how you're pushing the message out there.
Absolutely. And thank you to the listeners and the viewers out there for spending your most valuable resource, your time, once again with me on the show. Everything Cashflow Ninja is at cashflowninja.com. Over 800 episodes. And of course, you can grab a copy of my book, The 21 Best Cashflow Niches, on Amazon. I'll throw in, if you send a receipt to my team at info@cashflowninja.com, a digital version, an audio version, a curated library of interviews, and more bonus issues. Until next time, live infinitely. This presentation is for educational and informational purposes only. The information being presented and considered does not consider your particular financial objectives or situation, and it does not make personalized recommendations. This material is not intended to replace the advice of a qualified tax and legal advisor or other qualified professionals, and you should not use the information in place of a customized consultation with a licensed professional regarding your specific personal financial objectives, situation and needs. We believe the information provided is reliable, but we do not guarantee its accuracy, timeliness, or completeness.